We're going to be talking about, of course, I assume, how many are familiar with Daniel's numbers? The way, raise your hands if you've ever seen my presentations on Daniel's numbers. Well, not as many as I thought.
Yeah.
I actually thought there would be more, actually. Which that makes it good, because that means you are going... Actually, I'm not going into it that much. So we're going to cover, as if you kind of half understood it already. So the whole concept of Daniel's numbers is it provided a framework I began to put prophecy into. Meaning, I didn't rethink this too far. I had some speculation and some conjectures about things. But when Daniel's numbers kind of told me where to go, not the other way around. I didn't tell them where to go. Okay? So I just kind of followed the cookie crumb trail that led me to where I am. I didn't presuppose too much, although I did have some conjectures ahead of time of what I expected it to be, which proved sort of true, but it was a year after I expected it to be. It led us to this middle point here where we have a reversal of things. Actually, Isaiah talks about a reversal. There's a lot of different things that talk about a reversal of events that take place in Scripture and in time. So I actually took this point right here, and it surprised me how it all can, you know, centered into these points. The 2300, the 1335, the 1290, and the 1260 days all landed on the same day in the center. And that was a big aha when I computed all this out. That's a little preliminary, and if anybody had been into Daniel's numbers, I was actually going to take a few questions on the front end. So I was thinking I'd put this up, and if you had a few questions, I'd answer them on the front end, and then I'd get going. Because once I get going, I want you to put your thinking caps on, because I'm going to move pretty fast. Otherwise, we would be here 6 hours. I don't want to be here 6 hours, and I don't think you do either. However, I don't want to lose you either. So if I lose you, that isn't accomplishing anything either. So that being said, this is your chance for questions on the front end. Go ahead.
Yes, I just wanted that story where Joseph Smith said, "We will know, but we've been told, oh, no man knows the day or hour. You can't follow this." But where did Joseph Smith say that?
It's actually in the words of Joseph Smith is where you can find that.
The words,
okay.
Is that E. Hatt?
Yeah, Andrew Hatt's words of Joseph Smith. Anyway, and it's also in... I should have it memorized. One of the enzymes.
Oh.
Okay. It is
the magazine?
Yeah.
Okay.
Where he says you can know?
Yeah. Where he said we would know, it's in one of the enzymes, and I should memorize that, but you know, I'm getting old.
You have company.
Anyway, so that being said, the first part of this, I'm going to move fairly fast, and it might seem a little dry if you're not into math. Mm-hmm. Okay. I hope it isn't dry for you, but it's important that you understand that when you start linking all this up, everything comes together. And if it didn't all converge, I wouldn't be so confident of what I'm about to give you. But because so many things converge, I'm quite confident that the Scriptures have told us very clearly what's about to happen in our world and in our lives. And I'm going to start, if this works.
So, Pharaoh, I had heard that when that comment, no one knows the day or the hour, that's talking about when Christ comes in his glory. It's not referring to Adam on Diamon.
Right.
Yes, and we have actually given a presentation on that, too. I'm going to move this up. Hold that for me so I can come around.
Oh, you bet.
So that it's closer, so my clicker doesn't strain.
That's probably what the problem is.
Yeah. You want it on here?
That's probably a good
idea. That's probably a good idea. Put it there and then move this up.
Yeah.
Hopefully, that'll solve the problem.
Good. Oh, no, I can't do that.
Nope. Did you put the batteries in the right way? I did that the other day. I'm like, this don't work.
Did I bring my glasses? There's another question.
Oh, dear.
We have some readers.
Yeah, we all have readers.
You can turn the light on if you want.
Okay, it's working now.
Okay, great.
Okay, so I titled this, The Opening of the Seventh Seal, A Timeline. And the seventh angel sounded, and there was a great voice in heaven saying, the kingdom of this world had become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. So, you all probably knew this already. I'm Farrell. Okay, so I'm going to go into very quickly some of my most recent research. My most recent research, I actually was teaching over a year ago, I was teaching the first lesson of the Old Testament, which I called Bereshit. I don't know how many of you have seen that, but in Bereshit I go through and I show how the history of the world all culminates and comes to a particular point of history, which is the ending of the 6,000 years. So this, in Bereshit, I showed that the 6,000 years, and I actually worked in reverse from Adam on down to speculate when creation was. But true to form, I'm never satisfied. Okay, so the next question I ask, and I just got on my knees like I have for so many times to ask questions. And I says, well, you know, Father, you should be able to show me, using Genesis and Numbers, I should be able to connect these dots. If that's really true, I should be able to find it. And so this first part, I'm going to show you how wonderful God is that he answers questions when you ask them in sincerity and then go do like Joseph Smith said and study it out. And so in this first part, I actually am going to show you right out of Genesis, and I'm going to connect the timeline so we know when Adam started. Okay, so this is going to move pretty fast in the front end because otherwise you'll get bored to death. Okay, because it's math. This is DNC 77, verse 6. What are we to understand by the book which John saw, which was sealed in the book on the back of the seven seals? We are to understand that it contains the revealed will, mysteries, and works of God, the hidden things of his economy concerning the earth during the 7,000 years of its continuance or temporal existence. Okay, so in DNC 77, he says, hey, this Adamic configuration, and I'm going to use that word, this Adamic configuration is 7,000 years. Now, I don't want to get in and contend over carbon dating or anything like that. Just understand that's a whole nother lesson that we could hit. And I could hit hard from lots of perspectives. Okay, but I'm not going to hit that today.
Could I be invited to that when you're
going
to?
Okay.
We'll invite you back.
Okay. I don't want to hit that today because I feel like that's another 5-hour lecture. Okay. But this says that there's 7,000 years appointed unto this temporal existence. So do we believe the Bible? You know, some people don't, especially Genesis. They don't believe Genesis because they get all confused with the science. Like I said, that's a whole nother discussion, which I'm not going to take today. But that being said, I am going to show you that Genesis is consistent with Revelation, with Daniel's numbers, with all of it, because it all comes together beautifully. Okay, so this 7,000 years of its temporal existence minus 1,000, that means the millennium has to start at the end of 6. Okay? Right?
Right.
Simple enough. So far, that's math almost any of us can do. Okay, and this isn't going to be complicated math. I'm just going to move quickly. Okay, so I decided to just go to Genesis and lay it out. And this is the book of the generations of Adam in the days that God created man in the likeness of God made he him. Male and female created he them and blessed them and called their name Adam and the day when they were created. So created, if you understand what Joseph Smith spoke, that does not necessarily mean like the Christians would teach it. The Christians would teach kapoof. Okay? We don't believe that creation is kapoof in this world that we, I mean, in the LDS world we live in. We don't believe that creation is kapoof. We believe creation is the organization of things before. That existed. Okay, and that maybe those things were organized before that. But this creation is what we're talking about, and that's what's important to keep your mind on for now. And we're not going to discuss all the possible scientific complaints, because I think they're all answered, but I don't have time once again. So I'm going to say, Adam, I'm going to create my own new timeline, okay? I'm just bold that way. And I'm going to say Adam being born is the year zero, whenever that was. We're not going to say when it was yet, but I'm going to show you when that was later, okay? And so I'm going to call Adam zero is where it is. And then Adam zero being laid out, we're going to call it AA, after Adam, just for simple sake. So I coined my new timeline, you know, because we have BC and we have AD, and then we have all the different ways the Jews count it and everything else. But I'm just going to use my own marker, and I'm going to start with 0 AA. So Adam lived 130 years and begot a son, his own likeness, and called him Seth. Okay, so Seth being born 130 years. We're just going to start running through this really fast, okay? So we have, now Seth is born in the year 130 AA, okay? Then we have Enos at 105 AA, and I'm quoting this right out of Genesis 5, okay? So you can see it.
It's 235.
So we're now at 235, and we're just running forward here. And Enos lived 90 years, and we got Canaan, and we're just going to add Canaan in there, and we're now at 325, and I'm just clicking on through this, and like I said, you're just going to see the numbers clicking by here. So we got 70 years for Mikhailel, or how you say his name, okay?
Hallelujah.
Yeah, something like that. My weakest suit is pronunciation. Okay.
You should have Rhonda with you, because she always fills the gaps in.
I know. She thought she was coming, and then she thought it was 9:30 tonight, and I'm like, no. Then I'm stuck.
That's past my bedtime.
Me too.
Because she had already pre-set up other meetings, or she would have been here. In fact, she's really disappointed she's not, but such it is. Okay, so 70. Then we got 65 years for Jared. Okay, and we're just going to click through this, and this seems pretty repetitious, but it's pretty simple math, right? So far, we're just clicking forward. And this is all in AA, after Adam, just so you know. We're not linking that year zero yet anymore. So then we got Enoch at 162. And we're just clicking on through these. 22. And I'm just doing this really as fast as I can for you so that you don't get bored. Methuselah at 65. And that adds up to 687. And you're going, okay, this is real simple. Why didn't you just go to the end? Well, I wanted to show you that I didn't cut corners. Okay. Okay. Lamech. I can say it.
Lamech.
874. And he lived 182 years to Noah. Okay. So we have Noah at 156 AA. Okay. And then we say Noah was 600 years old when the flood of the waters came upon the earth. Okay, so now we can add 600 to that, and we get 656 AA is the flood. Okay? So, then you say, have you ever read Genesis and wondered why all these numbers were in there?
No, well, I've read Genesis, but never wondered about the numbers.
Okay. See, I'm this crazy guy that always wants to know why. Okay, I'm the why guy, okay? And so here we have 600 years to the flood. So we got that at 656. I'm now going to anchor the flood at the top because we're running out of room. And it says that he, say that name for me.
Shem?
No. He's 2 years after the flood, okay? So let's just add 2 years here. We're at 1658, and then we have 5 and 30 years. They say it backwards from the way we think. We would say 35 years, but they also write backwards from the way we think. So just get used to that, okay, in Hebrew. And we're just going to keep on going here, and we're at 1693 AA for Selah. Okay, and Satan lived 30 years, and he begot Eber, and Eber gets added in here, and you might say, this is getting boring, okay? But just to understand, we are clicking this through, so you know that this crazy guy up here in front of you actually does pay attention to detail sometimes. Okay, and so we have Peleg at 34 more years.
Do you mind if I ask a question?
Sure, go for it.
So how do you square that all of the geological evidence puts the flood at about 10,000 BC?
That's the other
discussion. That's another class.
Yeah. Carbon dating.
That's okay. The carbon dating slash.
I just wondered if you had an easy answer to that.
I have an easy answer. Believe God over any PhD.
I would say that's an answer, but I think there's other plausible answers.
Okay. Right, like factual answers.
Okay.
But that's a short answer.
Really, that would monopolize so much of this class.
Okay.
Rue is 30 years. That brings us to 1787. And where I'm trying to get down to is Abraham. 2 and 30 years. And we got Surug, 32. And I thought about just having this automatically run, and then I decided not to, because I thought I might get an interruption.
So, you're giving us time to write it down.
Yeah, so Nahor is 30 more years. And who's Nahor, by the way? Don't remember.
Don't ask.
So we got 9 and 20 years to Terah.
Terah, that's Abraham's father. Yep.
Now we know who he is, right?
Yep. Yeah.
Okay, Terah is Abraham's father. So now we're almost to Abraham. Okay, 1878 on the way to Abraham. How many of you read Genesis and then you hear science and you go, yeah, just like he did. So,
I converted from that stuff. So,
okay, so that gets it says, and Terah lived 70 years and begot Abraham, Nahor, and Haran. Well, why did they say it that way? Because God likes to make this work for things. All of a sudden, he just put all of them born at the same time. Are they triplets?
That's interesting.
Okay.
Hmm.
So this all of a sudden is your first.
Different mothers.
That's implausible. But this is all of a sudden the first time we get that hidden little gem.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And this hidden little gem is in there so that the average person is just going to pass over it and not even pay attention. And most of your, a lot of your timeline scholars have passed over it. However, your more efficient ones went to the New Testament. And in the New Testament, in Acts 7:4, in a speech that Stephen gave, it is said that a farther journey of Abraham from Haran to the land of Canaan did not take place until after his father's death. Okay, now as Terah was 205 years old when he died, if it was not until after his death that he left, Abraham wouldn't have been 75 when he left at Abraham's birth. Terah must have been 130 years old. So that 75, Stephen is having a contradiction with. And he's saying, no, it's 130. Well, now we get to have, so if it was 130, all of a sudden the timeline has two possibilities, right? We have the one in Genesis and then we have this. However, it's really answered right here. The difficulty is easy gotten over by supposing that Abraham, though named first on account of his dignity, understand he was the...
was not.
He was the one who would have had the birthright, if you want to call it that way, because of who he was in Scripture. He was not the eldest son, but probably the youngest of the three, born when his father was 130 years old, a supposition with which the marriage of Nahor with his eldest brother Haran's daughter, Milcah, and the apparent nearness of age between Abraham and Lot and the three generations from Nahor to Rebekah correspond only to two from Abraham to Isaac are in perfect harmony. So what that really saying is his oldest brother was actually born in 70 years after, and that he was born 60 years later. Okay, but in Genesis, it just labels them all three I think it's because sometimes he hides things up so that we have to search them out. But then he had Stephen reveal it. But then you understand that Abraham is labeled first in that list because of his ranking in our lineage in Scripture, okay? It puts it all in perfect harmony. Because what you realize is that Haran's son had a daughter that Abraham married, which back then was okay because the genetic pool wasn't messed up. Okay, so you know why we can't marry a brother and sister, right? Do you ever wonder why that? I mean, sometimes we just think it's weird in our society. So we,
yeah.
Okay, so it does seem weird, but the real reason is genetic corruption. Hmm. Okay, the reason why that it is against the law to marry your brother or sister is because if you have a genetic flaw, that is going to get double DNA'd into the children and causes birth defects and all kinds of problems. I mean, you know, and I realize culturally it's just out there for us. But the truth of it is, it's not, I mean, in this instance, it's actually his brother's, it's a cousin, what would that be, a cousin?
Cousin.
Niece, yeah, something like that, cousin. Anyway, so what I'm saying is it's not necessarily a brother or sister, yeah. The name, way we would think it, but she is referred in the Scripture as his sister, which would be cousin, really, in this sense.
I heard that was customary to call him that back then, too. Uh-huh.
So well, that may be true, yeah. But the truth of it is that Sarah was actually Haran's daughter. Okay, so it was cousin that he was married to. Okay. So that being said, you know, that would seem culturally unacceptable for us. But in those days, it was not culturally acceptable. Okay, so that being said, but it is genetically unacceptable. That's what I'm trying to point out.
Mm-hmm.
Because of corruption in the lineage of our DNAs, were we to marry, we would pass through the flaws, and then we'd get really weird birth defects, potentially, yeah. And stuff like that. Okay.
A lot of the royals did.
I'm sorry, what?
A lot of the royals did have problems.
Yeah, the royalties used to do that a lot, and they did have a lot of problems. So if we change that 78A to 130, we now have Abraham being born in the year 2008. Okay, so if he's born 2008, I'm now going to jump to something that's really fun in the book of Jasher. And you might have seen this before. I've done it in other presentations. But in the book of Jasher, it gives us a very clear sign in the heavens of Abraham's birth. Okay? In the book of Jasher, it says that the night he was born, that a very large star came from the east and ran in the heavens, and he swallowed up the four stars from the four sides of the corner, or from the four sides of heaven. And the wise men of Nimrod, okay, the wise men of Nimrod knew that this was a sign of something crazy on the night of Abraham's birth. But do you know what's really cool? In our day, we can find that sign.
Mm. Mm.
So that sign can be simulated on the same thing I've used for much of my research, modern astronomy. I can't speak today.
Astronomical.
There we go. Okay, astronomical software. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to show you that simulation. Yeah. Well, and I'm going to show you that date on our calendar, because the astronomy software works backwards to that. So that sign in the heavens is something we can find and did. Now, here you have in February, the month of February, the whole sign of the heavens running in the heavens. And you have Venus up here. Now, these two are actually pretty dim. You probably wouldn't have seen them. But you could see Venus, Mars, Jupiter, Mercury, and Saturn. Those are the four other planets, stars, whatever, in the heavens. And in the month of February, it starts running, and right about there, the light of Venus drowned out the other three, and they became in conjunction, or the other four became in conjunction. So what you just saw is the sign of Abraham's birth.
Mm.
So, wow. Now we have a linking point. to connect our calendar to AA. What's that?
When are you speaking of that we just saw? Is this a few days
ago? Well, he just shut
down. No. I was saying as this timed out. And, you know, just because I knew that question was going to come, we're going to do it again.
Do it again.
What?
Because it just happened again?
No.
No.
I'm just going to show
you. He's
going
to replay it.
I'm going to replay it. So you got Venus up here. This is in 1953 BC. You got Venus up here, and it comes down and gobbles up these other four planets because it's the brightest one. Okay? And that's why the very large star, actually, we know Jupiter's the biggest, but it's not the brightest.
Mm.
So to the eye, Venus is the biggest because it's the brightest. It's the closest to us. Well, it's the closest to the sun, actually. Mars is closest to us. They're both pretty close to the same. I can't remember the name. But there it runs, and right there, it would have swallowed the light up of the other four. So we now have just shown you the sign of Abraham's birth. Okay? So we have Abraham at 2008, and we have the sign of Abraham's birth at 1953 BC. We can come from both sides, BC being by Christ's birth. We can come from both sides, and we now have a date, 3961, Adam to Christ. So 3961 BC. Sounds good enough, right? That's cool. Well, if we take that and say that's when Adam was placed in the garden, and we add 6,000 years, that takes us to 2039 is the end of the 6,000 years. Now, when you see that, you go, wait a minute. That doesn't fit Daniel's numbers, right?
Or does it?
Well, no.
Okay, the big question that you have to ask
yourself. To you if it didn't.
What's that?
He wouldn't be showing it to you if it didn't.
Okay, so the big question is, why not? And I had another class I gave just this portion to. And it was actually a group of men in a priesthood setting. And because I had approximately the right amount of people in there, I asked every one of them in the class to tell me how many days or months between their birthday and their firstborn son's birthday.
Oh, thank you.
Okay. Guess what it should be? Average. 6 months, right? Because it could be as much as 11 and two weeks, or it could be as much as 2 weeks out from the father's birthday. But if you add a group of them together, it's going to average at 6 months. Okay? Did anybody follow that? Because it's important.
No.
Okay. My birthday is in January. My eldest son is the end of May, almost June. So February, March, April, May, June. There's 5 months between my birthday and my oldest son's birthday.
Birthday.
Okay. When it says all these people this old and then they had a son, we didn't take into account the difference in birthdays.
Oh.
Okay?
Right.
Okay, we didn't ever take into account the difference in birthdays. So if you took, which there is, 20 generations, that puts the millennium in 2040. Okay, so that being said, if you take 20 generations and take the average of 20, which would be 10, and add 10 years to that date, we now are 3971. You follow that? Is everybody with me? Okay. So now with that average birthday, we can now land 2971. And we have now the millennium starting in 2030.
Oh.
Do you understand that the millennium starting in 2030 would be in the fall? Because creation was on trumpets, so it would be the fall of 2030 to the fall of 2031. All of a sudden, if you're into Daniel's numbers, it's just going boom, 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 boom. Okay? Okay, so now all of a sudden, it completely works. Now, because I am also that crazy guy that keeps asking questions, okay, I did the statistical analysis of how far off of the median could it get before the odds just got crazy. Mm. Okay, so could it actually go to 2027 or to 2034? Which are interesting dates if you understand the whole thing. Okay, when you run the odds out that far, just 3.5 years from the median on 20 generations, I hope I'm not confusing everybody, but when you do that, you find that the odds are 1 in 5,000. Less, it's actually almost 6. 1 in almost 6,000 that it could ever happen 3.5 years earlier or 3.5 years later. I can accept that it could possibly be either one of those other two, but that's a pretty big stretch. So I kind of lean towards this one, just so you know. Okay, because this one is the median, statistically.
2029 or 2030?
25. You got to realize there's no year zero on the calendar, so when you add it together, you have to add that in. It's 2030, and it's the fall of 2030, but it's fall of 2031. It's trumpets to trumpets, which fits Daniel's numbers exactly. Okay? I did not force fit any of that. I just walked you through the math straight out of Scripture, and then the sign of Abraham's birth. I just laid it out. So what I just laid out for you, if you believe the Scriptures, and you believe that 6,000 years is from Adam to the millennium, you could just about nail it that it's there's hardly any possibility that it could be sooner than 27 and later than 34.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But the mean average is 30. Okay? Just so you're with me.
So that's obviously why Satan is doing his Agenda 2030 plan is, you know, he probably knows the plan.
And if you, yeah, absolutely. And he knows his time is short.
Yep.
And you know, the Scripture tells us that God is kind of going to allow this leash for Satan, which is much longer than most of us are comfortable with. Okay.
Yeah.
but he's going to allow this leash so that he can show mankind that we can't do it on our own. We need him. And then he's going to come to the rescue at a, actually right there shortly after, 6 months. Okay. Okay. He's going to come to the rescue because, well, number one, we're grateful of that. At least I am, anyway. And in the meantime, we have to prepare spiritually that we're prepared for these times. So, we pretty much can nail it down statistically because, you know, because of Daniel's numbers, I think you can pretty well rule out any of the dates between 2030 and 27 and between 30 and 34 because if it's not on one of those three dates in Daniel's numbers, which would be trumpets of 27, first fruits of 31, and trumpets of 34, then the in-between doesn't make any sense to me. It's going to be on one of the appointed times. Okay? I lean towards 31, just so you know.
It's spring, right?
Yes.
Spring. 31.
Yes, first fruits. We can help
you. It took me a minute to catch up. My mind was elsewhere. I had to pull it back. Okay. All right. So that's just interesting information to back up what I've already taught. Okay. That's what's cool is it actually does. By the signs in the heavens, everything backs it up almost perfectly. And when you consider the woman at the well, and you consider the 2 days of the Gentiles, the 2 loaves of bread, all of it coming from 2030 at the woman at the well, 2,000 years, and then a tithing being from 1830 to 2030 from the restoration of the church, being a tithing of the time of the Gentiles or the fullness of the Gentiles. You know, there's so many things converging here that, you know, it's almost beyond reasonable doubt for me. I just don't even hardly have reasonable doubt. Okay? Plus, I've had spiritual witnesses.
Thank you.
Which are probably the most important, but I actually believe that it's really easy to confuse emotional witnesses with the Holy Ghost. Okay? I think often we get an emotional witness, which is not a witness of the Holy Ghost. And that can sometimes confuse us. Okay? And it's for that reason I like to test everything. I like a second witness. And that second witness in this instance is the witness of facts. Okay? I like the scriptures to back me up. I don't want to just jump on my own and say, oh, I feel this. Okay. So I want to jump now into Revelation, the book of Revelation. And some of you see this and some of you haven't, but and there are seven kings. Five are fallen, and one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must be, it continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and is of the seven, and goeth into perdition. So tons of people have connected those dots as, you know, current heads of state. Okay, now there may be a cyclical rounding fulfillment of that. But understand the main fulfillment of this, because he says right here, when is Revelation given, by the way? Who gave it? Who recorded it, at least?
John.
John the Beloved, okay? On the island of Patmos.
Right.
Okay? So, which is, at his time, five are fallen. So he's saying the five that have fallen in this book of Revelation have fallen before his time. Okay, and the one is after at his time. So the five who have fallen are Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Persian, and Grecia, or Grecian. And the one that is Rome. Okay, so the five who have fallen, we know who are. We know the one that is Rome. And then it says, and the other has not yet come, and when he cometh, he must continue a short space. Now, I actually thought I'd change that, because I actually have a slightly adapted perspective on this. The one that is, I mean, the Turkish Ottoman Empire actually was kind of an extension of Rome. The two legs, you could almost say, were Constantinople and the, I'll call it the eastern leg of the Roman Empire. And then you had the western leg of the Roman Empire being the Roman Catholic Church, kind of adapting down through. And then you have the introduction towards the end of that, of the clay and the feet and the toes. Now, when you take that into account, that's kind of over-governing governments that have kind of ruled particularly over the Holy Land, then you understand that these governments that have run over is the beast, but then we have the whore. Who's the whore that rides the beast? So many people have talked about that. Who's this great and abominable church?
Catholic church.
No. Okay. Well, the answer is yes, but not just.
Right.
Okay. I would say yes, it is part of, but the Catholic Church didn't exist in the time of Babylon.
That's true.
The Catholic Church didn't exist in the time of Egypt, Assyria, Persia. Mm. But you know what did? The pagan religions.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, the pagan religions, which, I'm sorry, but Catholicism is mostly one of those pagan religions.
Yeah.
Okay, it absolutely is. I don't want to offend anybody here, but at the same time, our main Christian holidays were hijacked by Constantine and the pagan religions.
Right.
And instead of celebrating Christ's birthday when it happens, we celebrate it on Tammuz and instead of celebrating the resurrection, we celebrate a celebration to the goddess Astarte for Easter. And, you know, I don't want to shake your box too hard, because I don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater. But the bottom line is, when you go through the last week of Christ the way the scriptures actually say it happened, you find that he was actually resurrected early Monday morning, not Sunday morning. That's a whole nother discussion also. Okay. But our celebration of the goddess Astarte handed to us by the Catholic Church is not only a pagan adaptation of a very sick worship of killing the children and then coloring eggs in their blood. Okay, Easter eggs, you know.
That's where it started.
These things come from a very sick background.
Yeah.
Okay, and Constantine gave this, and then he combined it with Christianity, and he diluted our thinking. Now, I don't want to rain on your parade, because the resurrection is beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
But some of the stuff that we were handed down, not so good. Okay? And that, I'm not trying to throw water on your parade. I'm just trying to say, you know, if you really study it, yeah, a little painful almost. Because...
And the pagans try and convince you that it's the other way around, that we took it from them.
But
no,
the evidence is in there when you do the research.
Oh, no, I know. I agree.
Okay. When you go deep enough, you understand that it all is pretty... I know. They also... I've seen an article or presentation that... that the stars don't show the signs of the heavens, but that we actually created our whole worship structure around astronomy.
Check.
And we actually worship the gods, you know, that we're in the heavens. And I'm just telling you, Satan loves counterfeits.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. And he loves to still, all you got to do is look at modern politics.
Yeah.
I mean, everything they do, they blame everybody else of doing. So that they can cover it up.
Right.
Okay. I mean, it's just all over the place. You can see they're in this, oh, yeah, and then they're the ones secretly doing it behind, and they're doing everything. And I'm moving way too slow. But it is fun to talk about the things that are pertinent to our day. Okay. So in Daniel 2, he says, oh, thou, O king, sawest that, and behold, a great image, this great image whose brightness and excellence shade before thee, and in the form thereof was terrible. And the image head was of fine gold, and we're all familiar with this, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So that's actually showing you that my interpretation of Revelation is correct. Because in Daniel's day, two kingdoms is already gone, which are Egypt and Assyria. And so Babylon's the first. Okay? In Daniel's, or it actually was Nebuchadnezzar's dream, but Daniel interpreted. So the two kingdoms before that were gone, and rightfully so, because... The dream isn't going to be given to Nebuchadnezzar about the two kingdoms before. But he does do it after that, which is Babylon, the Medes and the Persians, Grecia and Rome. Okay? So you have that layout in Nebuchadnezzar's dream, and you know exactly how that all fits together. In the process of that, then we go to Daniel 4. And we have this weird thing going on that I have never heard anybody give me an accurate description of that I'm comfortable with, okay? And in Daniel 4, he goes on to say, and the tree, he starts equating this as a big tree. And the tree which thou sawest, which grew and was strong, whose height reached into the heavens, and the sight thereof to all the earth, whose leaves were fair, and the fruit thereof much, and it was meat for all, under which the beasts of the field dwelled, and upon the branches and the fowls of the heavens had their habitation. It is thou, O king. So they're saying that this kingdom we're talking about is this tree that is Babylon. Okay? This kingdoms of the earth, which is actually inherited from this pagan... where's the name Babylon come from?
Good question.
Tower of Babel.
Oh.
Tower of Babel.
Oh, yeah.
Tower of Babel. Babylon. Okay? So the Babylon... is a marker of Nimrod. There's back to your pagan roots, okay? Nimrod, who in all of these things we're talking about, he is the ultimate pagan religion creator and defying God. I'm going to build the, you know, Tower of Babel or Babel or Babylon. Keep going from there. Thou art grown and become strong, for thy greatness is grown and have reached unto heaven, and thy dominion to the end of the earth. And whereas the king saw us a watcher and a holy one come down from heaven and saying, you down the tree and destroy it, yet leave the stump and the roots thereof in the earth, even with a band of iron and brass in the tender grass of the field, and let it be wet with the dew of heaven, and let its portion be with the beasts of the field till seven times pass over. Seven kingdoms. Spoken of in the book of Revelation. Seven times pass over. Or you could even take it bigger on a bigger cyclical scale, 7,000 years. Mm-hmm. Okay. So he's saying, this tree's going to get you down. Now, we know Babylon did get you down, right? In fact, we know today that of all those kingdoms, Babylon's the only one that doesn't exist. Egypt still exists. Mm-hmm. Syria still exists.
Yeah.
Rome still exists. In essence, Roman Catholic. I mean, we have all these signs, but he did say a band of iron, a band of brass. So what do those represent? Well, iron was Rome, and brass was Greece. So if iron's Rome and brass is Greece, that means that what came, of all those kingdoms, do you know that Grecia never got conquered? Okay, Grecia just dissipated into the four generals of Alexander the Great. Okay, the four generals of Alexander the Great went forth from there, and actually they went to Alexander the Great as he was in his deathbed, and they said, you know, who's going to rule when you're gone? They wanted him to appoint somebody, and he said, the strongest. That's a good way to start a war. You know, you could say Grecia never fell, but the four generals did. King of the North fought the king of the South, and that comes into the book of Daniel later too, and you start to see those connecting factors. And the Antichrist is a typed in Antiochus Epiphanes, and Antiochus Epiphanes was of that Seleucid Empire, which was the North, king of the North, in the whole discussion in Daniel. But what he's really saying is, you're going to leave the stump. What does that mean? What got left? The culture.
Yeah.
Okay, the culture of Rome and the culture of the Greeks, practically what we got taught in school is, you know, the Greek philosophers and the Greek gods and the whole, I mean, many of us got taught all those things, at least in my day, when we were in school. I'm dating myself, maybe. Maybe that's not taught anymore. I don't know. I haven't been to grade school for a while, or junior high or whatever. But in that situation, what I'm trying to tell you is, one of the biggest things we all kind of love is romantics. Romantics. Romantic. We love, in our culture, we love romantic. We love romantics. Roman antics.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And we absolutely look to Socrates and some of the Grecian philosophers and Plato and as some of the, at least the world looks at them as the authority, so to speak. So we kept the Greco-Roman culture. It's actually what the West really is. The West, I'm speaking to the West nations that are. We are the Greco-Roman culture. Anyway, he talks about the beast in Daniel 4, and he says, I don't know if you're familiar with what happened to Nebuchadnezzar, but he got bragging, and the Lord took his sanity. And he became crazy, and his hair grew long, his fingernails grew long, and he went out as a wild man into the woods, so to speak. And as he's out as a wild man, his reason and his kingdom really didn't have a head when Nebuchadnezzar was in the state, officially, but there's a lot of speculation that Daniel actually kept it together for them because he was Nebuchadnezzar's right-hand man. And it says, and his heart had been changed from a man, and let a beast's heart be given unto him, and let seven times pass over him. So we're back to there. So what that's really saying is, this pagan empires of the world get a beast's heart. If you don't think the beast's heart's been in Rome and Assyria, have you seen the craziness that has happened in the name of these countries? I mean, the amount of persecution that came from Assyria on all these beastly heads is gut-wrenching. It's probably the best word to say it. So these nations that we see laid down here in Daniel 8 and 3 through 6, I'm going to read. Then I lifted up my eyes and I saw and beheld there stood before a river the ram. And so we had the ram with the two horns, and the two horns were high. And then the other one came down. Then I saw the ram pushing westward and northward. And the beast, sorry, I'm in a bad angle. And southwest, so that no beast might stand before him. Neither was there any that could. So this is talking about when the ram comes in, which is Alexander the Great, and hits the goat, and hits the ram and destroys it, being Alexander the Great hitting the Medes and the Persians. Hope I didn't confuse you because I said that backwards the first time. And as I was considering, behold, the he-goat came from the west in the face of the whole earth, and he touched not the ground, and the goat had notable horns between his eyes. And he came to the ram that had two horns, which is standing before the river, and ran into him with great fury and power. Now, something bothers me here. This is talking ram, but we have Babylon, Media, Persia, Grecia, and Rome, but yet the emblems seem strange, okay? Most philosophers have blended this all together. I say philosophers, most scholars, it's a better word. Most scholars have blended this all together. And I saw him come close to the ram, and he was moved with choler against him, and he brake his two horns. And there was no power in the ram. So what happened here is Alexander the Great took out the Medes and the Persians. And then all of a sudden we get down here, therefore the he-goat waxed very great, and when he was strong, the great horn was broken. And four came out of them, four generals. Okay, those four generals. But then you move forward, and all of a sudden it says, out of one of them came a little horn that waxed exceedingly great towards the south and towards the east and towards the pleasant land. By the way, pleasant land?
Israel or America?
Israel?
It's Israel.
Yeah.
Okay. So the first of that, the type in the past, Isaiah 46:10. I will show you, I ought to learn to quote it exactly.
Yeah.
But by the things of the past, the things that will be in the future. Mm-hmm. I think I could quote it once, but my memory's got too many cars in the intersection. Okay. Okay. So the little horn is, type and shadow-wise, is Antiochus Epiphanes. But it is a type of the future. The whole thing is a type of the future. And that type of the future has been playing out in our very recent past. Now, to us, we think recent past is 5 years. But I'm talking over the last 150, 200 years. Okay? Okay. So we have this he-goat hit the ram. There's Antiochus Epiphanes, and I heard the man's voice between the banks of Uri, which called and said, Gabriel, make this man understand the vision. And he came near to where I stood. And when he came, I was afraid and fell upon my face. But he said unto me, understand, O son of man, for at the end of times shall the vision, or shall be the vision. What? I thought we just talked about the past. So there you are, Isaiah 46:10. He is showing us a historical event to give us a future look at what's happening. And he said, behold, I will make thee know what shall be at the last end of thy indignation, and I can't speak today at all. For at the time appointed, the end shall be, when you were here before, if you've been here, at the time appointed is at the Moed.
The what?
Moed. How many know what that means?
You've taught us, and I don't remember.
Okay. Moedim.
Appointed time.
The appointed times. It's the name of our website, propheticappointments.com. Okay? Prophetic appointments are the Moed. What are they? Any takers?
It's the Hebrew feast days.
The feast days.
Oh, okay.
That which we think doesn't matter.
That's dusty historical relics.
Yeah, dusty historical relics. And yet it's in the Bible, right? And so we like to just say, well, that was done away in Christ. Why do we even care? Well, I have to ask you a question. Does God do anything frivolous?
No.
Then why did he give them to us? Why did he command Passover, Tabernacles, Pentecost, First Fruits, Unleavened Bread, Day of Atonement, trumpets. Why did Why were they observing all this stuff?
So you could track the times.
It's a calendar. Mm-hmm. It's an appointment calendar. And you know that because he fulfilled it precisely during the last week of Christ.
Yeah.
Okay? That which he did in the Exodus was type and shadow of the last week of his life. Perfectly. At the time they're celebrating Passover, well, you could actually go at the time that the lamb is selected on the 10th day of Nisan would have been the triumphal entry. Exactly. And that day that they select the lamb on the triumphal entry, that he comes into Jerusalem riding on a donkey, they were actually celebrating, and the donkey he took was the one the high priest was supposed to bring in the lamb from Bethlehem, in the temple lot in Bethlehem. Okay? And he got on the donkey and he rode in front of the high priest, just probably 10 minutes ahead. Okay? And they're all lining the streets like a 4th of July parade. Okay? And he comes in and the Pharisees are going, "What are you doing? Why are, you should silence your disciples because they're praising you and you're not the lamb." And he's like, "Oh, guess what?
Yeah,
I really am. Okay, I really am the lamb. And if these people didn't cry out, the rocks would cry out." But they were already there. They were already lining the streets for the very selection of the lamb. I will rephrase that, the presentation of the lamb. Nisan 10, very much in the last week of Christ on some of our presentations on that. Then 4 days later, well, we'll go 3 days later, by the way we think, but it's actually 4 days by the way they think, okay? In the evening, Thursday night, he has a Seder service with his disciples. And then he goes into Gethsemane. And at the anniversary, the perfect Hebrew anniversary of the angel of death passing over old Israel, the angel of spiritual death passed over you in the Garden of Gethsemane. It couldn't be a more perfect fulfillment. Mm-hmm. Then that same day, we would think next day, because we're Gregorian, Greco-Roman thinkers, okay? We're not Hebrew thinkers. But it's actually the same day, because it starts at the evening to the evening. But very early that same day in the morning of the Last Supper, he is placed on the cross. And at 3 o'clock, he fulfills what's going on in the temple. And what's going on in the temple is at 3 o'clock, the high priest in the temple stops the daily the sacrifices for Passover, and he says, "I thirst," and they bring him water. At the same time, Christ is saying it on the cross. And then he raises his hand. "It is finished." It couldn't be a more perfect fulfillment. Mm-hmm. That should tell you that he meant business about these appointments. Okay? That should tell you that when they come again, in a cyclical rotation, it's going to happen again. 3 days later, he is resurrected at the same time they're offering the first fruit offering and the beginning of the count of the omer. He offers the sacrifice they wave the offering to the heavens when he says to Mary, "Touch me not, for I have not yet presented the first fruits to the Father." Mm. You can't make this stuff up.
No.
It's just beautiful that he was the first fruits and he presented the balance of the resurrection that followed him to the Father. Okay, that happened on First Fruits, which is Resurrection Day. I almost used the E word. So, when you
What's
think...
What's the E word?
Yeah, all of us are wondering.
Oh, okay.
Easter.
Oh,
okay. Okay, so I almost used the E word. But I don't try to make a big enough issue with everybody that they feel crazy, because you can't be judged for what you don't know.
Well, why does the church then? Why don't they stop that?
I can't answer that. Yeah. I don't have an answer.
I just don't think their thinking has progressed that far. They're so busy running a worldwide church, worrying about sin, and all this, and the church educators have just not dug that deeply.
Well, and I don't know.
That's my explanation.
Daniel says in Daniel 12, knowledge has not been increased. This stuff, I'm the crazy guy that just brought this stuff out. Who's going to listen to me?
No,
okay.
Well, just keep following the traditions of man.
What I'm saying is, and I don't think it's been so important that we haven't fixed yet.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
With Halloween, All Hallows Eve was to prepare for All Saints Day, but look what stuck, not honoring our ancestors.
Exactly.
Yeah.
We end up taking out the bad side of a tradition most of the time, it seems. But all I'm simply saying is I'm not here to tell you I know any idea why they don't. I just know what I know.
Yeah.
And I have to live to my conscience. Okay.